Hello everyone, I'm Zach Peterson. Welcome to my channel. Today I'm doing, I think, my first ever design video on high-speed design. And this is in response to a viewer question that I received in my personal email. So I'm gonna run over that question and then we're gonna get onto the whiteboard. And I think this is gonna be a really great intro for all the folks out there who are new to PCB design because it relates to some really fundamental stuff that happens with high-speed digital. So let's jump onto the board and get started. So before we jump on the board, let's take a look at that question. Scott writes, "Hi Zach, I am having some problems with a PCB that uses SPI and I can't figure out why. I am breaking out the SPI lines to an ASIC and the lines are having a lot of overshoot or ringing. I do not know if this is X-talk, meaning crosstalk, or not. I was surprised at this because my clock rate is only 10 megahertz, so I would not expect this problem in my board. Any help you can give is appreciated." Thank you very much for the question, Scott. And unfortunately, without looking at your PCB layout, I couldn't really tell you if this is crosstalk or not. If you get traces too close together, then sure, it could be crosstalk. If the traces are far enough apart, or if they're on different layers separated by a ground plane, then probably not crosstalk. Now that being said, you brought up something important in the question, which is what could cause this problem that you're seeing. And I think this really relates back to something fundamental about digital design. You brought up the clock frequency of 10 megahertz on an SPI bus. Now here's the thing, the clock frequency actually doesn't matter. What actually matters is the rise time of the signals on the bus. So to see why this is the case, let's look at a typical graph of a signal that would be part of a stream of clock pulses, okay? So generally what happens is your clock turns on, the output signal rises up to some high level, we'll call this VH, and then later it drops down to some low level, of course in this case it's zero, and then this whole period counts as, we'll just call it the on time. Now, within this on time, you have a rising edge and a falling edge. And so this rising edge and falling edge are really what are responsible for all of the signal integrity problems that you're referring to, whether it's crosstalk or whether it's overshoot and ringing, or it could even be ground bounce. What matters here is this time interval that I've marked in red. And so this is the rise time. Now, the fall time also matters as well. And the rise time and the fall time are usually pretty close together. So what we care about here is the rise time. Now, here's something very important that you need to know about clocks that are used in modern digital circuits, particularly in CMOS buffers, which generally have a push-pull type of topology. And that's certainly the case here for SPI. When you have this type of topology, the rise time could be very short, even if this on time or this clock frequency is very low. To see why that's the case, you could technically take this falling edge and you could move it very close to this rising edge, and your clock pulse could look like this. So you just have this very short on time. And so any rise time that fits within this on time right here could technically be valid and form a clock pulse that rises up to the full scale voltage. That also applies in the other direction, right? This pulse could look like this, but we could have a rise time that looks like this. So we could have a very fast rise time even though we have a very low clock frequency. So that should illustrate why the clock frequency doesn't really matter. Now, it is true that as you get to faster and faster clock frequencies, you do get to shorter and shorter rise times because, of course, if I have a very short clock pulse that looks like this, I couldn't fit in a rise time that basically takes, let's say, this long in order to rise up to the full scale voltage. So it is true that as you get to faster and faster clocks or higher clock frequencies, you get to shorter rise times. But the reverse is not true. Very low clock frequencies, such as the 10 megahertz clock that you're dealing with here, could also have very fast rise times. So the question now becomes, how fast can these rise times actually be in an interface like SPI? And how does that compare to something like maybe I2C, where you don't see the same signal integrity problems? Well, for SPI, it really depends on the construction of the buffer that is in your processor or in your ASIC. but the rise times could be as low as, let's say, 5 to 10 nanoseconds. And this value right here is something that I seem to recall reading in one of the STM32 data sheets, right? STM32 is a pretty popular microcontroller, of course, and they list the rise times that they've measured for their outputs on their GPIOs, and those GPIOs could be configured as a spy bus, and so that would be the rise time of this particular bus. Now, if you look at some other components, such as, for example, some ASICs that I've used in some more advanced designs, those spy buses can have rise times all the way down to 2 to 3 nanoseconds. That's, of course, about a fifth to a third of the rise time of a different component like the STM32. So your signal integrity problems, if you have them in this case, are going to be like 3 times as bad. You can get 3 times the crosstalk just because you have 1/3 of the rise time here. Now, it's not just the rise time that plays a role. It's really the edge rate of the signal that is being output from that component. So what matters here is not just the final voltage and it's not just the rise time, it's actually the rate of voltage change divided by the time it requires for the voltage to change. So in this case, this would be, of course, T rise, okay? So let's just say, for example, we have a component that has to do a delta V transition of, let's say, 3.3 volts. And it's doing this in a 10 nanosecond time period. That's going to be 0.33 volts per nanosecond. As this rise time has gotten faster, or it's gotten smaller, what has happened to core voltages? Well, core voltages have also gotten smaller to compensate. So now let's compare this to the case where the core voltage here, or the voltage transition, is lower. So before we had 0.33 nanoseconds for a 3V3 bus, 0.33 volts per nanosecond, excuse me. So now let's suppose that we have a delta V over T rise fraction here of 1.8 volts, and it happens in 5 nanoseconds. Well, that's going to be 0.36 volts per nanosecond, right? So these numbers are pretty similar, and it's this number that's going to determine how severe a crosstalk problem might be if you have one in your PCB. It's also going to determine how much radiated emissions you might expect from your PCB if you have an EMI problem. So as these rise times have scaled down at more advanced technology nodes over the years, the core voltages have also scaled down, and part of the reason for doing that is, as you can see here, it is to control the noise that is coming from these interconnects and help to control crosstalk. And as you get to even faster interfaces, running at, let's say, gigabits per second, these are no longer measured in nanoseconds, they're measured in picoseconds, or in fractions of a nanosecond. And so the signal integrity problems have the potential to be even worse, and that's particularly true for crosstalk. So they will drive a specific load capacitance, they'll measure the rise time, and that's the rise time that they're going to quote you in that data sheet. And in general, if you were to double the load capacitance, then of course you would expect a doubling of the rise time as seen at the pins on that receiving component. So I've thrown out some rise time numbers for you, for example, here on SPI. But how does this compare to a different bus where you might not see these same signal integrity problems, like I2C? Well, I2C has a different topology, and that topology is open drain. Now, with an open drain topology, essentially what you're doing is you are sinking your input voltage across a resistor through a transistor. And this transistor is driven by some signal, and then this then drains into ground. So you have a bus here, and this goes out to your receiving component, and then this pull-up resistor powers up the bus. And then once this transistor is toggled on, all of that power drains out of the bus, or all that charge drains out of the bus, and then it rises down to its low logic level. So here we have some bus capacitance, we'll call it C bus, and then this is typically a 10K ohm resistor. How does this compare with SPI? What kind of rise time could we expect in this case? Well, in something like I2C, where maybe we have a typical bus capacitance of, let's say, 20 picofarads, we know that the rise time is basically approximately 2.2 times R times C. Well, if I take 2.2, multiply by R, multiply by C, I get a rise time here of 440 nanoseconds. So this is a much longer rise time. Now, even though you may have this VCC being all the way up to, for example, 5 volts on older components, or being 3.3 volts, you can already see that we have such a long rise time here that the delta V over T rise fraction here is gonna be much smaller than in the case of an SPI bus. So this is the reason that an I squared C bus doesn't create those same kinds of signal integrity problems that you see on an SPI bus. Now, as far as the solution to your specific design, what could the solution be? Again, I don't know without looking at the design, but there could be several things that you need to do in order to ensure that you don't have the ringing in the overshoot or crosstalk or both. One of those things is, of course, to use a ground plane below your spy lines. Just route everything over a continuous ground plane. And if you're a beginner designer, I know you want to do everything on 2 layers, but get in the habit of doing things on 4 layers, because really for working in the professional world, a 4-layer stackup is an entry-level stackup. Next thing you should do is make sure that you have bypass capacitors and decoupling capacitors near the power ground pin pairs on your components. That will ensure that you can provide power to all of these interfaces very quickly, and it helps to reduce that overshoot. The next thing you should do is terminate the bus, either with series termination at the driver or parallel termination at the receiver. Now, this is, of course, very important when you're trying to drive spy lines that are very long, because then you'll have a signal propagating on that bus and it could reflect off of the receiving end of that bus. And if the bus isn't matched to the right impedance using either series termination or parallel termination, then you could get overshoot as seen at the receiver. Now, that last point is something that I'll discuss in more detail in another video. I've talked about it in the past on Altium Academy videos, and I'm sure I'll talk about it when I create a course based on all this PCB design stuff. So make sure to hit the like button, hit the subscribe button to stay tuned for all of that cool content. Thanks for watching this video, everybody, and thanks for tuning into my channel. Of course, you can see all of my PCB design content on Altium Academy, and if you want to see all sorts of other cool stuff related to PCB design, make sure to hit that subscribe button and subscribe to my channel. Thanks again, everybody, and we'll see you next time.